Chapter 7. The Talks Go On. Now to resume the story of the holiday that the professor and I were spending at Dalhousie. Our stay was most enjoyable. We had thought that the great master had gone there for rest and relaxation, but no, here also he was never free. Many people came daily to see him. Pandit Thakur Dutt Sharma, the proprietor of the famous medicine, Amrit Dara, who had his own house at Dalhousie, was a constant visitor. Raizada Hansraj, a barrister from Jalandhar and member of the Viceroy's Legislative Council, who also had a bungalow of his own there, came to see the great master several times with a number of his friends. These meetings were very interesting and enlightening. On one occasion, a Muslim family came with two ladies in long black silken veils, burqas. I reproduce below a part of the conversation that took place at this meeting. One of the Muslim ladies asked the great master to pray to the Lord to grant her request. It afterwards transpired that her husband was a candidate for ministership in the Punjab government, and the appointment was soon to be announced. The great master replied that since enlightenment he had never prayed for anything, and this remark quite naturally took everybody by surprise. Rai Zada Hansraj asked, "Why, sir? Prayer is allowed in all the religions." "But is not resignation to his will much superior?" asked the great master. "Instead of asking the Lord to give us this thing or that, why not remain content with what he, in his wisdom, deems fit to give us?" One of the Muslim gentlemen said, "But everybody prays." "There are two kinds of fakirs, even among the Muslims," said the master. "One, Ali Dua, those who have recourse to prayer, and the second, Ali Raza, those who believe in resigning themselves fully to the will of God. They never pray for anything. They abide by his bana, or maj, his will." "What is the harm in praying?" asked the Muslim gentleman. The great master replied, "The Ali Raza says that if God manages the affairs of this world, and he is perfect wisdom, does he stand in need of any advice, request, or suggestion from us? Or would he agree to accept any proposal which he considered wrong or mischievous? Should we say to him, 'Please do this and do not do that'? After all, what is prayer if it is not a disbelief in the wisdom of God and his goodness?" put in Professor Jagmohan Lal. Rai Zada Hansraj then said, "Actually, prayer seems to proceed from the assumption that God is going to commit a mistake, and it is our duty to tell him about its sad results beforehand." "But there are prayers even in the Vedas," interposed Pandit Thakur Dutt. "One should pray only for the Lord's mercy and grace and for forgiveness of sins," said the great master. "Why pray for the transitory and petty things of the world?" Maulana Rum says, "Do not blacken your heart with anxiety for worldly trash. Do not ask from God for anything but himself." Guru Arjan says, "To ask for aught but thee, O Lord, is the arch affliction of all the afflictions." "This aspect of prayer is quite new to us," remarked Rai Zada. "And what strange prayers are made," said the great master. "A few days ago, I received a letter from a gentleman asking me to pray for his pet cat, which was ill and had not taken any food for several days. Now, this request did not come from a silly girl or from some rustic villager. The writer was an educated and cultured European gentleman. People ask you to pray for their cows, horses, pet dogs, cats, and squirrels. Now, what does this signify? They know, at least the satsangis do, that all pain and disease come as a result of a jiva's past karmas, and that this debt of karmas must be paid. Kal must have his pound of flesh if not from the jiva concerned, then from the master, who takes upon himself the burden of that jiva. All this is perfectly well known to satsangis. Yet they prefer that their sadguru should suffer pain rather than their cats and dogs? Doesn't that mean that they love their dogs more than their master, whom they profess to be their God Almighty? Pundit Thakur Dutt asked, then one should not pray? No, prayer has its own advantages, said the great master. It brings humility and removes one's pride and haughtiness. Bringing one's helplessness before one's mind, it tends to make a person devotionally minded, pious, and godly. Our whole life should be a life of prayer. It makes us pure-hearted, only we should not pray for worldly pleasures. Sir, can you give us an example of a good prayer? The Muslim gentleman asked. In reply, the great master said, if I were to pray, I might do so on the following lines. My Lord, I am ignorant. I do not know what to ask of you. Give me that which you think best for me, and give me the strength and wisdom to be happy about what you deem fit to give me, and about how and where you keep me. I have no virtues, no devotion. My actions are all dark and sinful. I possess no merits, and my mind has thoroughly crushed me. For a sinner like me, O Lord, there is no refuge but your blessed feet. Please take me under your shelter. I want nothing more. Make me your slave, that I may be yours and you may be mine. Marvelous, said the gentleman. The great master then recited the following prayers of Kabir and Dhanajat. All had a hearty laugh over these. Kabir's prayer. I, a hungry man, cannot perform your service. Take back your rosary, O Lord. I ask for the dust of saints' feet. I owe not anyone anything. O Lord of wealth, how can I pull on with you? If you give me not yourself, then shall I acquire it by begging of you? I ask for 2 seers of flour, with 1/4 seer of clarified butter and salt. I beg for 1/2 seer of pulse, which shall feed me 2 times a day. I ask for a cot with 4 legs, as also a pillow and a mattress. I beg for 1 quilt to cover me. Then your slave shall perform your devotional service with love. I have harbored no avarice. Your name alone becomes me. Says Kabir, my mind is thus pleased. When my soul is pleased, then I recognize the Lord. Prayer of Dhanajat, a peasant saint of Rajasthan. O Lord, I perform thy devotional worship. Thou arrangest the affairs of those persons who perform thy devotional service. I beg of thee flour and ghee, so shall my mind be ever pleased. Footwear, good clothes, and corn of 7 sorts I beg of thee. A milk cow and buffalo I ask for, and also a good Turkestani mare. I ask for a good wife to look after my home. Thy slave, Dana, O Lord, begs thee to procure them. These prayers are meant to show how little we need and how much we ask for, the great master remarked. But we do not get what we pray for, said Pundit Thakur Dutt. The Lord can and does give everything, the master replied. But the question is, what should we ask for? I would like to relate a personal experience of my own in this respect. I was still in service and was in charge of the military subdivision of the Muri Hills. Muri was an important military station, and the government undertook an elaborate scheme of water supply for that place. Water was to be brought from a long distance, and the pipeline had to pass through some very hard and solid rock. I was put in charge of executing this work. The first month's experience showed that if the work of cutting through the rock was done with chisels and other small cutting tools, the progress would be so slow and the cost so great that it would be impossible to finish the work within the time fixed and within the grant allowed by the government. In 1 month, we completed only a couple of furlongs, and 1/4 of the grant was exhausted. I brought this fact to the notice of higher authorities and asked for permission to carry on the work by means of blasting. This permission was granted, and the work began to show better results. When we reached the last mile, which passed through the European quarters of the city, our pipeline had to pass through a road on which most of the shops belonged to European merchants, and on which there was also a big cathedral. The owners of the shops and the clergy of the cathedral served notice on the government to the effect that if any damage was caused to their property, or if their glass windows or other articles were broken due to blasting, the government would have to pay for their losses. We again took to rock cutting by chisel, but the stone there proved to be the hardest of all, and the cost of cutting the rock was 10 times higher. The government was in a fix. A meeting of the high officials of the department was called, but they could find no solution to this dilemma. All the discussion and racking of brains proved of no avail. In the end, my chief turned to me and said, "Have you no plan or proposal to solve this difficulty?" I told him that just then an idea had occurred to me, and that I would be able to manage this work if he allowed me to buy a few hundred sleepers of wood. "Buy any number you like. We will leave this matter entirely in your hands and shall be greatly obliged if you will help us out of this difficult situation," he said. And after that, they all took their leave. I again tried the blasting, putting 2 or 3 layers of heavy wooden sleepers on top of the rock to be blown up. The trial proved successful, and we progressed very well. In the beginning, I myself personally supervised all the operations and did not dare to leave anything in the hands of my subordinates. But by the time we reached the quarter where the big shops were situated, my subordinates and laborers had become efficient and expert in this method, and I felt quite reassured. One morning, when the blasting work was proceeding in front of the cathedral on one side and the biggest European shop on the other, my servant brought me some milk to drink. That morning I had left my house a little earlier than usual and before breakfast was ready, so I had asked him to bring me some milk at my place of work. I told my men to explode the detonators that were set and turned aside for a few minutes to drink my milk. When I returned, I found the blasting had been a complete success. "Now let us put sleepers on the remaining 2 detonators also," said I.
"But, sir, we have already lit them," said my overseer.
"Have you? My God, the sleepers have not yet been put on them. You will be our ruin, my man," I exclaimed.
There was not a second to lose. I ran towards the 2 unexploded detonators to try to put out the fuse if I could. On the way, one of my European subordinates caught hold of me with both his hands. "I cannot allow you to be blown to pieces," he said. "Let me go, Francis," I said, but he would not. It was then that a prayer involuntarily escaped my lips. I had been very recently initiated by Babaji Maharaj, and I now turned to him in all humility. I would not have minded the effects of the explosion on myself, but the thought of what the European officers would think of us, Indians to whom they had entrusted the execution of this most important task, troubled me very much. After waiting for a few minutes, I rushed to the spot where the detonators were. Everybody else stood aghast and breathless, filled with anxiety for my safety, as my subordinates and staff loved me very much. On getting hold of the fuses, I found that they had fizzled out after burning for only a quarter of an inch. How? I do not know up to this time. There was nothing wrong with them. Afterwards, those very fuses were used, and they proved effective. "Ah," said the Muslim gentleman, "this shows that God sometimes accepts prayers, but what is the criterion laid down by him for their acceptance?" The great master smiled. Then he replied, "Your eyes see only the present. The Almighty sees beyond time and infinity. We should obey him and receive with pleasure whatever he gives us. We should not even take any steps to ward off arrows shot by him," was the master's comment. It is said of Rabia Basri, the lady mystic of Basra, that she never took any steps to cure her illness or remove her poverty, accepting these as gifts from the Lord, said the Muslim gentleman. Continuing the discussion, the great master said, "Guru Arjan Dev, the fifth guru in the line of Guru Nanak, who lived in the time of Emperor Jahangir in the 17th century, was severely tortured by the governor of Lahore under the orders of the emperor. He was made to sit on a red-hot iron plate, and hot burning ashes were put on his naked body. Mia Mir, a Muslim fakir who visited him in his prison cell, could not bear the sight of such outrages being perpetrated on a servant of God. He therefore asked Guru Arjan Dev to permit him to destroy the city of Lahore and to raze it to the ground with all of its tyrants and their tyrannies." The guru merely smiled and said, "Dear brother, first answer me one question. Is all this being done against the will of my beloved Lord? If not, then sweet is the pleasure of abiding by his order." "The world has often treated its great men very cruelly," said Raizada Hansraj. "How cruel," explained Pandit Thakur Dutt, "to torture a person simply because he does not worship God in the way you worship him." "Why is that so, sir?" the Muslim gentleman asked. "Logic and love face in different directions," said the great master. "Love knows no law, and logic knows no love. Law and logic are meant for the affairs of this world. To the abode of the beloved, one can fly only on the wings of love. As Nuri says, 'Throw thy hundreds of books and papers in the fire. Refresh thy mind with the love of the Lord. Let the garden of thy heart bloom with the water of his love.' Saints come and sing of nothing but the love of the Lord, his ishq. They do not interfere with the rites, rituals, ceremonies, or religions of the world. They simply leave the world and its lovers alone. If a marriage is to be performed, they say, 'Go and perform it according to the custom of your society, or in whatever way you like.' The purpose is only to unite the hand of the bride with that of the bridegroom, and to tie them together in a matrimonial knot. Do it as you think best. If a dead body is to be disposed of, they say, 'Bury it or cremate it as you like.' A child is born? Well, christen it as you deem fit. God does not care to interfere in these petty affairs. He wants your love and purity alone." Trouble arises when the logician tries to force his theories into the realm of love and God. He wishes that the Shariat, given for the purpose of leading a peaceful and orderly life in the world, should guide the lovers of God also in their love affairs with their beloved. Footnote: Shariat, the Persian form of the Arabic Sharia, the Islamic moral and religious laws, which were laid down in the Quran and the Hadith, the traditional sayings of Muhammad. End footnote. They cannot realize that the love of God and God's love for his lovers is limitless. It cannot be circumscribed, limited, or confined within any boundaries. The lovers transcend all laws. They become merged in the beloved and become the beloved himself. Why was Mansur, the king of lovers, tortured and beheaded? Because he cried out in his ecstasy, "I am he." The barren philosophy of the uninitiated could not comprehend the height of his flight and rendered a verdict of blasphemy against him. Shamsa Tabriz was put to death for bringing a dead boy to life by saying, "Arise by my order," after the boy had not risen when he said, "Arise by the order of Allah." Great Kabir says, "The saints accomplish what the Creator cannot." Paltu says, "Saints are so near and dear to God that he never refuses what they want him to do." The hair-splitting logician finds it impossible to comprehend this and believes that what he cannot understand is not possible, not knowing that there are realms where reason cannot enter. "But the laws of Shariat also must be followed," said the Muslim gentleman. "Certainly, within their province," the great master replied. "But passing beyond Shariat, religious and moral laws, and Tariqat, the spiritual path, there are the domains of Marfat, divine knowledge, and Hakikat, merging in reality. A student should not always cling to his primary class lessons. Mystics have laid down 4 stages of spiritual development. Shariat is the first one. But living a good moral life is not the ultimate goal. After this, a seeker steps into Tariqat. He has to search for a true master and, under his instructions, follow the spiritual practices that will take him to the door of the Lord's palace. The third stage is Marfat, realization, in which he receives divine knowledge. The fourth is Hakikat, to be one with the Lord. Who would like to remain permanently tied to the first stage if he has knowledge of the higher stages and knows that they are essential for one's spiritual development? "Is the above your path also?" inquired the Muslim gentleman. To this the master replied, "The path of the saints, to whichever country, race, or religion they may belong, is always the same. It is the same for all ages and climes. It is not a human design that may require some addition, alteration, or modification. It is the Creator's own design, and was created along with human beings. It is the same for all ages and for all humanity." "Sir, what is the Muslim name for your system of spiritual practices?" asked the Muslim gentleman. The great master smiled a little and said, "Muslim saints call it Sultan al-Askar, which means the king of all methods." The Muslim gentleman then said, "Sir, the Hindu doctrine of the transmigration of the soul is not clear to me." "I shall try to explain it in a few words," said the great master. "Our desires are the cause of our birth and rebirth in this world. Ask, and it shall be given, is a law of nature. Our life is shaped by our desires and longings. What we desire, nature manages to supply. Our birth, the place of our birth, the family and the conditions into which we are born, are all regulated eternally by this law. We are taken to the place to which our attractions draw us. It is our love and attraction for the forms and figures of the world that drag us down here again and again. The keener the attraction and yearning, the quicker we get the object of our desire. Now, our desires have to be fulfilled, but not necessarily in this very life. Circumstances now may not be favorable for the fulfillment of a certain desire. Accordingly, that desire is registered in our antakaran, the subtle part of our mind that records all impressions, and nature starts to take measures for its satisfaction. But it naturally requires time, and this again depends upon the type of the demand and its intensity, or otherwise. If the present body is not suitable for its satisfaction, a new body will be supplied, in which the unfulfilled desire can be best satisfied. Suppose, for example, that a young married woman dies without a child. She had been praying all her life for a son, and this desire weighed heavily on her heart at the time of her death. Well, nature may give her a body, say, of a female animal, through which she will get in each litter half a dozen offspring every 6 months. Nature is very relentless and strict. Bodies and forms do not make any difference to her. She looks only to the desire that is imprinted on the antakaran, and which remains the same whichever kind of body one goes to. It seems very cruel to bring a person down from human stature to the life of a low beast, said one of the gentlemen. Nature is certainly very strict, the great master replied. You will not find such severity and rigor in the laws of any government as in the realm of nature. But is it not a fact that we often find a person's conduct to be much worse than anything of which a beast could be guilty? Would not nature be justified in sending such a soul to a lower level, where it would be in a more suitable environment to reap the fruit of its actions and to gain experiences that would lead to its development and future elevation? With this law of transmigration, another law, the law of karma, is very closely associated and intermingled. As ye sow, so shall ye reap. Footnote. From Marcus Tullius Cicero, De Oratore, 1165, and also the Bible, Galatians 6:7, whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. End footnote. The debts and liabilities you incur must be adjusted. The balance sheet of your old debts always keeps hanging round your neck wherever you go. Now suppose you put your son in a school. He regularly attends his class and works diligently, so that at the end of the year, his headmaster thinks him fit to be promoted to the next higher class. But suppose he has not been learning his lessons, not even attending his classes regularly, but has wasted his time in wandering idly in bad company, so that he loses his efficiency and becomes unfit to be kept in that class. Won't his teacher be justified in putting him back in a lower grade? In the same way, this world is a big school to which we are sent by our Father to learn the lesson, to know the truth and reality. There are many classes and grades in this world. If during our lifetime we learn the lesson for which we are sent here, to know ourselves, to realize our Creator, and to return to our true home, we would surely be promoted to the next higher class, to spiritual regions. But if, instead of learning our lesson, we unlearn what we had learnt in the previous class, that is, we act like animals and behave like beasts, surely we would go back to the class of animals and beasts. Remember, nature is not extravagant. It gives that form to an individual in which he can best satisfy his unfulfilled desires and cravings. If, in human form, such desires and cravings are created that befit an animal, the next birth must be degradation to an animal form.